Today's talk is entitled The Mayan Calendar, The Greek Olympic Gods, and Environmental Change. And the final statement of this introductory introduction to the video is nature proving they are right? And so we've have our changing sun, but I want to talk about the Mayan calendar, obviously all the expectations of what the New Age movement was saying. Nobody wants to talk about the Mayan calendar anymore. It's sort of like, oh, it's an embarrassing hiccup. I believe that what the Mayans were telling us is actually being proved to be right. So really what you've got to do is you've got to ask yourself the question is why did the calendar exist to be before the Mayans even took root? My understanding is that it was handed down by any more ancient cultures, and there's some beliefs that they it was handed from the Olmec, and from the Olmec it was handed to them. So it's something that is probably very ancient, that's been improved upon over the years. But we have to have a look at this calendar, that which obviously starts and predates the Mayans themselves. And if we go back to the start of the Mayan calendar, and obviously, you know, it was about 3,100 and whatever, 14, I think it was. If you then go back to the records and say, well, what was happening on the Earth at that time? And there's a webpage from Stanford, I think it is, and it's got a number, hundreds of links about the Great Shock of 3200 BC. And obviously it's plus or minus 50 years around the time of the start of the Mayan calendar. And what they talk about is weather that was changing, species die off in terms of trees, other trees growing at different heights, flooding in the summers, wet summers, and so all the and if anyone's got access to, I think it's Stanford, you can see all the publications that they're talking about. They even talk about the start of the mound building society, and you know, and societies in general starting the this age. You know, they talk about the start of writing, and you know, so at this age, which is the age of the ego or the demon, or the start of the Mayan calendar, we had climatic change. You know, cold summers, hot winters, you know, wet weather, you know, glaciation, you know, it was a violent, stormy time, which is no different from what we're experiencing now. You know, we've got South Pole sea ice increasing, we've got North Pole sea ice decreasing, we've got sea levels in Antarctica dropping, we got the, you know, you know, it's the whole environment is changing, and this is seen today, and the Mayans got it right, or whoever handed the calendar over. We are at the cycle of the most strangest sun that we've ever seen, or in modern history, and there's been a lack of sunspots, and this just happened by chance that the Mayans had this right. You know, we can say, well, you know, Hathaway, our leading scientist, had it totally and utterly wrong, the NASA leading scientist, who said it was going to be the highest sunspot cycle of all times. You know, and he's got that totally wrong. So anyway, so the Mayan calendar, or the Hab, was the solar, and so going back to the Mayan study of this and where this has come from, was a solar calendar made up of 18 months and 24 days, plus a period of 5 days, and these were the nameless days of turmoil. So the Mayans had a mechanism of monitoring sun activity, and they talk about, you know, the age of the Hopi talk about the age of the fourth and fifth sun. And so in 2012, in March the 9th, I think it was, we had one of the orbs with the tails blast off the surface of the sun. Now, if this isn't a changing sun, nothing is. I put a little video up. It will be difficult for people to see, but there were three orbs that blasted off the sun last week. There are a number of frames missing out of it. It was when the moon, supposedly the moon, went in front of the sun, so you can see a black disk move in front of the sun. But of course you have these blastings off the sun, and I've obviously collected a number of these small videos which I'm going to analyse. But these things are blasting out of the sun. Now in the picture that I put forward, I made this prediction back in, 2007, when I found the Hans Glacier woodcut, that this activity around the sun would be seen. Orbs form from the field. The sun is on the field. The sun forms orbs. Orbs are delivered to the sun, and there's an interaction between the sun and orbs. Simple. Provided you've done 20 years of research on it. So anyway, so the Mayans got it right. They didn't get it wrong. You know, we see a strange sun. We have no sunspots. The sun is not doing what it's supposed to be doing, or what it was predicted to be doing. And obviously these helio viewers go down on certain times, so you can't see what's happening anyway. Why should I need to see it? Because I already know that I'm right. I've been proved right on the solar minimum, and I've been proved right on this solar activity. But nature, not Paul Muir, is unveiling herself. What is in the minds of scientists is in the minds of men. What is nature's laws and rules is in nature. I just stumbled across it. I worked extremely hard. I spent a lot of time trying to understand my environment. You know, and unfortunately or fortunately, depending on which way you look at it, and depends on whose perspective you're looking at it, I got it right. I got it right that there was a solar minimum, or a sunspot minimum. That even, you know, the words are being changed to a solar grand maximum. There's no reference to sunspots now. There are very few sunspots, and a very, very strange sun. And this is part of the prediction, you know. Hans Glacier told us about the strange sun. They are cycles within cycles. There's great cycles, like the Mayan calendar, the 13 Bactoon cycle, and there are small cycles in which Hans Glacier's solar minimum or the spora minimum sits on it. So it's just a reflection of a smaller cycle. And so the Mayans were right. You know, we haven't seen anything yet. So we go to the Mayans, you know, were just there. Or the people who first observed their calendar, because the Mayans were into murder, death, kill anyway, so they were sacrificing blood to the sun. So were they there? What do they know? You know, they were handed something from the ancient ones, and lay claim for it for themselves, I suppose. It depends on how you want to look at it. They improved it. Possibly they improved it, but certainly the cycle of which they were talking of is a real cycle. So we come on to the Olympian messenger gods. I think they're Linear B, which is the oldest writing of when writing first formed. This obviously Linear A, Linear B. This is where these Olympian gods were first referenced. These were merged into, they were a trade language. I talked about the trade language moving from the Library of Alexandria into the Caves of the Dead Sea Scrolls recently. But this language is sort of a universal ancient language, trade language, and they talk about the Olympian messenger gods, and this is where we get the giants from in the Old Testament. But they're not giants. And so what we have is the Illuminati use all these ancient Greek names because they're whacked out, and they want to tell us some sort of twist our minds into derangement or something like that. I'm not quite sure what game they're into, but love them, you know, they're just they're psychopaths that have climbed to the very top while the compassionate have held the door open for them. You know, the psychopaths who climbed the ladders. So anyway, one of these Greek gods are the I want to talk about our weather on the planet, and Hyades is the name of class of nymphs who numbers and names and descent are described. I'm reading from a Babylon Greek dictionary, Roman biography and mythology dictionary, described in various ways by the ancients. The common number of the Hyades is 7. They appear in the constellation which bears its name. So we have a god, 7 of them, that are related to rain on our planet. The story which made them daughters of Atlas relates to their number was 12 or 15. And originally there were obviously 12 or 15. First 5 of them were placed, so they could have moved in the heavens. So we got stars now that are moving in the heavens, as the star of Hyades, and 7 or 10 of them have moved afterwards to the Pleiades. So they're talking about stars moving away from clusters, you know, from, so, you know, astronomers really need to have a look at this mythology, as many other scientists have, including all the studies of the Hermetica. All of them have looked at the Hermetica and come up with theories based on the ancients. Of course, they probably with their egos wouldn't. Newtonian occultism is a classic of it. So, you know, but they're looking at this ancient text and they realize that it's right. You know, so their name of Hyades is derived from the ancient Hyas, a surname of Dionysus, or the mystic surname of Dionysus, and they formed the U in the heavens. So they are clearly talking not about people or gods or men in spaceships. They are talking about the heavenly bodies. Obviously, the Illuminati have come along and again with their deranged minds. You know, they just want to just chuck mud in the water. The last thing they want to know is that our ancient ancestors knew more about the, and I'm talking about the very ancient ones now, I'm not talking about, you know, anything in from this age. It's just about cutting out people's hearts, murdering people, and calling up demons and whatever. So the most natural where the word Hyades is from is vain. Or terrain, as in rain. The constellation of Hyades, when rising simultaneously with the sun announces rainy and stormy weather. So they're talking about a planet, the Hyades, and many of the other of the sisters of it, you know, Ambrosia and the other planets that form the Hyades and the Pleiades, affecting our weather on our Earth. And of course, science would say that is absolute ridiculous ideas, because it's a linear mechanistic model, and you know, Big Bang and black holes and blah 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 and whatever they try and tell us, which is absolutely wrong. It's so wrong. I mean, they ridicule and laugh, you know, laugh at these ancient stories, and yet their stories are just so unbelievable, they're beyond. Because nature is going to unveil herself. She is going to show mankind, and particularly the deranged scientist, that what they have said is in the minds of the deranged, or the minds of men, and not in the mind of nature itself. It is not a process that works that way. And they will be falling around, and they'll be, you know, very, very deranged, you know, because all their years of work have gone down the pan, but they should have looked at it properly. So going back to the Greek mythology, and the Hyades were the five daughters of Atlas, half-sister to the Pleiades. After the death of brother Hyas, the weeping sister were transformed into a cluster of stars. So they're talking about how the cosmos works now. And afterwards it rained to Earth. As an Igirai object, the Hyades cluster has been known since prehistoric time. Now, years ago I was talking about the Nantaro effect, where the stream from the bull and particles streaming in from the Taurus constellation are streaming into our solar system and affecting our planet and brought bad weather back in the Bronze Age. And the ancients knew this. They named their place names after this Nantaro effect, or streaming particles from, it doesn't matter if it's not the Taurus constellation, it's particles streaming from their gods. And they are the Titans, the giants. And so I just put up one of the videos, this is from 2009, but I'm referring to other videos, the earlier videos, and earlier research about the Crab Nebula pulsing energy through into our solar system. And recently, science of now, this is a recent publication from, I think it's 2011, August 2011, where they say that cloud formation may be linked to cosmic rays. So they get in there, you know. They must be, you know, I'd be a bit arrogant to say that they're watching my channel and then thinking, oh, hang on a moment, this boy's onto something here. I'm not onto anything. All I'm doing is, you know, I study the Orbar wave. Yeah, that's fine. You know, I know how this particle carries information and charge through the universe. You know, so it recharges planets. It isn't a big bang. You know, it's pretty simple. It does seem that as though it's simple only to me, though. And so the scientists now are catching up. You know, they're talking about peer-reviewed papers of cosmic rays forming weather on this planet, on Earth. And that is as I was predicting back in 2007. So they are catching up. Whether they're catching up to me or whatever, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to me. And so what we have is solar minimum increased in cosmic rays, solar maximum decrease in cosmic rays, and obviously with this peculiar sun, with this peculiar sun and the weakened, I suppose I better give a better explanation to it, right? So it's a boiling hot summer's day, and we got our windows open, and it's windy, and so, you know, pollen will blow through the house, and you will see the curtains moving and whatever. And obviously a hay fever sufferer closes the doors, and we get no effect in you. And that's all that's happening, is that when our magnetic field is strong, and when our sun's magnetic field is strong, it's our doors closed, and none of this cosmic ray flux is coming in. And when we open our doors and windows, it blows through our house. And this is what's blowing into our solar system. It's blowing into the sun and causing the sun to change. It's causing the manufacture of orbs and the exchange of energy from orbs. Because this cosmic ray is basically charged orbs of a charged orbs which are doing different things. You know, in my book I talk about the categories of orbs. And so the all these breakthroughs are coming through now with the latest telescopes and whatever. And of course it's what I've been predicting for since the completion of the book. I had a look and started to generate the theories of how the universe truly works, because it works around the orb bar wave. The Pierre Auger collaboration has announced today, that's November, the past November, that high-energy cosmic rays that rain down on the Earth's atmosphere do not come evenly from space. They have plotted the direction of these particles originate from and have found patterns for the first time. Most of them come from a particular type of galaxy. So they're streaming now are they saying they're streaming in straight lines? Are these the magnetic ley lines of the Earth? Are they the cosmic tree? Well, of course they are. I mean, you know, they're beginning to understand that the cosmic tree was the thing that linked all the planets together. You know, Gaia had an energy system. You know, the universe hasn't. Our solar system has an energy system of interchange. And you know, and these are known as active galactic nuclei. So what does an active, what are these active galactic nuclei look like? And then that's I've just added one in. And of course, I used this image, which is from Chandra, from the Crab Nebula. And of course, it goes back to Greek mythology as well, about the source of light and blah blah blah. You know, I haven't really got the time to do the research. You know, I could spend years on just the one Greek messenger god. That's not it. It's up to other people too, and they should really be contacting me, and I would, you know, share some of this information with them. You know, because now's the time when nature will reveal herself. The Mayan calendar will, you know, be describing something that, the age of a new sun, the Hopi's fifth sun, and we've got a rebirth of our sun, and our sun doing very strange things. So anyway, so that is the inactive galactic nuclei. And so they've observed these particles and cosmic rays coming from the center of them, like you can see in the video. I mean, even this, I talked about in the Anunnalish. I talked about the Nirubu and from the Sumerian creation poem. And they even understood the jets from the center of these spiral galaxies, or the Crab Nebula. They even named it a solar calf. So they knew all about these things. And so what we have is the Hyades, Pleiades, and the Crab Nebula in a similar region of the sky, streaming particles from their active galactic nuclei. And the Olympian gods, or some of the gods of bad weather, or are now being recognized, or at least the energy. So we have streaming particles now from certain galaxies. They talk about them from black holes. I don't even believe that black holes are what they are. They say they are, they're not. They don't even exist really in true terms. You can see something of a similar effect in space, but it's a place where energy is created and decreated. It's an in and out. It's a point on a field where energy comes into the universe and out of the universe. And suns sit in the center of these, and many other things do as well. But energy is created from these points. It pushes it into the universe and out of the universe. And they're nothing to do with, the mass of what's coming in and going out causes the effect of gravity. It's gravity doesn't cause the effect of the black hole. It's a byproduct of it. But anyway, people don't really want to need to know that. So what they found is the Atlantic hurricanes linked to cosmic rays and geomagnetic disturbances. This is why some people are saying, "Oh well, all these hurricanes were created by HAARP." The HAARP may have an influence on these things, but we are also getting a fluctuation in cosmic rays. I mean, certainly HAARP can damage our magnetosphere and allow more cosmic rays in. So yes, HAARP could be the reason why our magnetic field is being breached all the time, because they're creating holes in it. But anyway, this is a publication. It's a PowerPoint presentation from one of the scientists saying Hurricane Sandy in three cosmic ray neutron records. So we have record cosmic rays and we have a record hurricane. And we have these cosmic rays traveling down lines through the universe from active galactic nuclei. And the Greek messenger gods, they come into reality as being, they're telling us what the universe does. And so there's a particle called a spinon. I would class it as a monopole spinning cosmic orb. A bit of a mouthful, depending on whether it's a left or right hand spin or whatever. But so these are the cosmic rays or particles that they talk about, but I'd call it in those terms. And what happens is they hit our atmosphere, they move to the equator at the boundaries of magnetic charge, and they are mass causing the spin. And so we get from space, orbs from space, or charged particles, cosmic rays if you want to call them, because the wave forms the sphere when it hits magnetic fields. And so what we have is as these amass in at the equator, while they're spinning, they create a spin in the upper atmosphere, and we get our hurricanes from space. Now the one of the Olympian gods, let's see if I can, he was one of the giant gods of violent storms. So these are the giants. They were giants in those days, you know. Summoned forth from the stormy pit of Taratus. Now Taurus and Taratus, and it had a single an orb. They even in the Greek records from, I think it was either Homer or it's referenced in a couple of places, that it had an orb as an eye. Right, so this is where the Cyclops comes in, but the orb and the eye. And from its shoulders, it has multiple arms. Right, so you have an orb with an orb with an eye. They're even using a language that I would use. So there's orbs with holes in, but we can call it the eye of the storm if you want to. And that eye of the storm spins, and it spins out like what you would see in a spiral galaxy, is multiple arms, and this is where the tornado or hurricane comes from. And so these are the gods of violent storms. You know. Nothing difficult about that, really. It's just that we wanted them to be people for some reason. And so as these monopole cosmic ray orbs, whatever you want to call them, because, you know, they're spinning particles, the orb is spinning in either clockwise or anti-clockwise direction, bringing charge to the Earth, which is, as I suggested, the magnetic field of the Earth is going to start to increase. The magnetic field of the sun is going to change, and we are living in these times. And what evidence do I provide? Well, you know, there's nothing greater than the Hans Glaser effect of the last mini cycle, of where these globes and orbs danced around in the sky, and eventually, I mean, these orbs that are attaching to the sun and blasting off the sun's surface, the main image is from this week. It's not as clear as it could be. It's not as clear as the one that happened on the 9th of 2012. And there were three at that time anyway. There wasn't just one. If you have a look at the video of it, you will see another three of them blast off, but then in the distance on the sun. So we got our sun with the orbs coming out of it. The Mayans were right, or their ancestors were right. I don't like them, and I'm not particularly fussed on the Mayans because they went into the murder, death, kill. You know. And so everyone can say, well, you know, this arrogant man from Lankwavada who's observed something of nature and got it right. Climate change in the quiet sun. I mean, this is from last week, I think it is. 2012. I don't know what date that is. October 2012. And so even the Global Warming Policy Foundation are admitting that the sun is quiet in terms of sunspots. And it's a peculiar sun. The Mayans got it right. The Olympian gods, that we created aliens in spaceships and giants and all sorts of rubbish. And we are facing the change. We've already been through a good part of this change, because we've seen things like tsunamis and those things were occurring 5,000 years ago at 3,200 BCE, and we are going to be seeing a major solar orb event. I've become convinced of that, and we're pretty damn close to it. So it will change once nature reveals herself, or itself, rather than referencing it as a male or female. We will begin to reconnect with her or it, and we will begin to connect with these fields of energy, which will transform our very soul. Thank you very much for everyone listening. Sorry, it's a bit of a rant. For those scientists who are generating new theories from my work, why not just send me an email and I'll talk to you directly. Cheers then. Goodbye.